A guy recently asked me about our program. I told him, because of our tremendous crew, every show is all that and a bag of chips. And because of our tremendous crew, the bag is empty. We have plenty to share with you, though, tonight on NEOtropolis. This is not business as usual. Welcome to NEOtropolis. We are not business as usual. Hi, I'm your host, Jim Evans. We are excited to say that tonight's show is going platinum. Well, at least that's the case for a Northeast Ohio company with a very familiar name. They've achieved that status by doing what no competitor or similar company has done anywhere. And you'll want to have the right snacks to complement your viewing, too. We'll get you to that shortly, but first, we take a look at regional business news from the NEOtropolis Good Business News Aggregator.
This is the good business news along the I-77 corridor for the week of January 17th. Tuesday's Cleveland Plain Dealer front page reports that the Mahoning Valley Development Group will begin seeking approval from the Ohio Racing Commission to build a horse track to be part of a $300 million entertainment complex that will include a hotel, golf course, shops, and, if the governor approves video slot machines, a Las Vegas-style casino. If the proposed racetrack casino is developed, Ohio would have 4 casinos and 8 racetracks in total. Tuesday's Cleveland Plain Dealer business section reports that 80-year-old Mayfield Heights Brushed Engineered Materials Incorporated is changing its name in March to Materian Corporation. The new name better reflects what the company has become as they have developed new technologies. For the first 3 quarters of 2010, Brush Engineered Materials had sales of $946 million, and they employ about 2,500 people worldwide. Wednesday's Cleveland Plain Dealer business section reports that Beechwood-based Elyrius, an aluminum processing and recycling company, has broken ground on its second plant in China. Formed by the 2004 merger of Kentucky-based Commonwealth Aluminum and Texas-based IMCO Recycling, Elyrius has 42 plants in the United States, Europe, and Asia. Wednesday's Akron Beacon Journal business section reports that in the next 15 months, Cleveland-headquartered Key Bank will add 5 new branches and about 30 new jobs in Northeast Ohio. Thursday's Akron Beacon Journal business section reports that Akron-based First Energy Corporation is one step further along in its plan to merge with Greensburg, Pennsylvania-based Allegheny Energy Incorporated. First Energy is seeking to buy Allegheny for $4.3 billion in stock and assume about $3.8 billion in debt. The merger is expected to close in the first half of this year. This is the good business news along the I-77 corridor for this week. NEOtropolis is your source for good business news.
Before we move forward, we must offer a disclaimer. This episode of NEOtropolis may produce a ripple effect or kettle effect or homestyle, or, well, there's plenty more. So munch on that for a few moments. As you do, we'll reach into our content partner bag for the Business Journal. It's time for the Weekly Buzz.
I'm Stacia Ertis with the Business Journal Weekly Buzz for Youngstown and the Mahoning Valley. 2 Cleveland developers announced plans for a $300 million racetrack and resort in the Mahoning Valley. Rick Lertzman and Dr. Brad Pressman are the principals of the Mahoning Valley Development Group and want to build the Mahoning Valley Downs and Resort on up to 700 acres. They say it would include a thoroughbred racetrack, hotel, golf course, shopping, dining, entertainment, including a water park, and a casino. The group still has not said where it intends to build the resort, and it still needs to get a racing license from the state. As for a casino, they say the project will go forward, even if video lottery terminals aren't legalized in the Mahoning Valley.
The racetracks have fallen on hard times, but our concept is to make sure that we have an entire resort destination site, the racetrack being a key element but not the only element.
Pressman says the project could create 1,000 construction jobs and up to 2,000 permanent ones. State lawmakers are questioning the timing, saying they've been approached by at least 2 other parties also interested in a racetrack in the Mahoning Valley. The Lordstown-built Chevy Cruze posted the second highest sales for Chevrolet last year. Chevrolet reports it sold 4.26 million vehicles globally in 2010, an average of one every 7.4 seconds. Only the Chevy Silverado brand topped sales of the Chevy Cruze worldwide last year, with nearly 335,000 Cruze models sold. Two Northeast Ohio economic development institutions are opening satellite locations in Youngstown and Warren. Magnet, headquartered in Cleveland, will have a consultant working out of the Regional Chamber's Warren office. And the International Trade Assistance Center, ITAC, which is part of the Kent-based NEOtech, will have a trade advisor housed in YSU's new Williamson College of Business Administration. In the latest edition of the Business Journal, Incubators Nature is to Nurture, a special section on the region's business incubators. The Youngstown Business Incubator continues to take good ideas to global markets, with Jim Kostler, the YBI's chief evangelist, saying the deal flow is the best they've ever seen. And when dealing with software, location is no longer key.
It's absolutely irrelevant in software. In fact, we would argue that you're crazy to be in the Silicon Valley, where office space can run as high as $200 a square foot, and it runs $8 in Youngstown, Ohio.
You can read more about the YBI, the Warren Innovation Center, and the Akron Accelerator in the January edition of the Business Journal. And those are this week's headlines. Be sure to check out the Buzz newscast every business day online at businessjournaldaily.com. I'm Stacia Ertis. We'll see you next week.
And now it's time for a NEOtropolis fact.
Did you know that Northeast Ohio colleges and universities posted a 50% growth rate in research expenditures from 2000 to 2008, outpacing the remainder of Ohio, the Midwest, and U.S.?
Sheer perfection in every bag. That's the guarantee of a company in Massillon that has flourished and grown for some four decades now. Shearer's Foods has been among the leaders in the snack food industry. In fact, they're at the top with their leadership in energy and environmental design. Shearer's mode of operation is unique in many other ways as well. And as Jennifer Bohr shows us, this is not snack food business as usual.
We are at the Shearer's manufacturing plant here in Massillon. And this is the Shearer's you're probably used to seeing. But today, we're taking you inside the company because, for example, you probably didn't know they are the first snack manufacturing plant in the world to be awarded LEED Platinum certification in 2010. It is definitely not business as usual.
This is where the process of making Shearer's tortilla chips called tangos begins. Corn is cooked, soaked, separated from its shell, and turned into masa dough. The dough is then cut into chip shapes. The chips are baked and get a quick dunk in oil to add flavor and crispness. The chips are separated by quantity, bagged, and placed into boxes to be shipped out to stores. These Tango's chips are just one of dozens of different products being created at this facility alone, playing a role in the overall success of Shearer's Foods.
Shearer Foods has been around for about 37 years. We started our company as a distribution company for Wise potato chips.
Shortly after that, Shearer started to produce their own potato chips. The company has come a long way from its humble beginnings, according to Bob Shearer, co-founder, chairman, and CEO of Shearer's Foods.
Started our company with four associates, my mom and dad and brother and I, and today we have roughly about 1,550 associates.
As their number of employees grew, so did their production space.
We started in a 2,500 square foot building, and we had one fryer that produced 125 pounds of potato chips an hour.
Today, Shearer's has six manufacturing plants, including this one, and the company has close to 1 million square feet among their production facilities.
Our Millennium plant in Massillon, Ohio, is the first platinum LEED certified food manufacturing company in the world. And I felt that as a company that, you know, from a sustainability standpoint, it was our duty to, you know, to preserve the natural resources that we use.
This facility was officially launched on August 13th when Shearer's leaders, employees, and various dignitaries gathered together for the ribbon cutting. Even Rob Watson, founder of the LEED Green Building Rating System, was at the event.
This building has achieved a real milestone in that it's one of a very small handful of any manufacturing plant of any type to have achieved the platinum certification. And it is the first manufacturing facility that is in the food industry that has achieved the platinum level.
According to Rob, LEED verifies that a building was designed and built to improve performance in five main areas: sustainable land use, efficient water use, energy savings, healthy materials, and good indoor environments. A platinum certification means a building has achieved superior performance in each of these areas, and it is the highest level that can be reached.
One of the criteria is to restore the land, and so they replanted their disturbed land with Ohio prairie. Instead of paving all of the drives and parking lots, they're using gravel, which allows the rain to seep into the soil. They use light color surfaces which don't heat up and then cause higher air conditioning use in the building. They capture all of the rainwater and reuse it in their sanitation and sterilization processes.
We take sustainability very serious. I believe as the CEO, you know, it's my position that I want to become as sustainable as we can, and so it's part of our mission. Like I said, it starts at the top, but it filters down to all of our associates, and it's sort of like a domino effect.
Bob says there is now 35% less natural resources being used in the Millennium plant. Just as sustainability is part of their culture, so is keeping a strong sense of community and family among employees.
It's all about the people. That's what makes us different. We're such a quality-oriented company, quality people that make quality products. And so I think we try to exemplify that. And with all of the different little programs that we do.
For example, a wellness program and annual awards for employees with perfect attendance.
We have a drawing for each plant, and the winner of the drawing gets an additional week's vacation, and they win a cruise.
Peggy Gratigan in Human Resources says the company also has a caring and sharing program that is open to all Shearer's associates.
And it is a committee group that we raise fundraisers. We do all different types of fundraisers, such as basket raffles, bake sales. We also have what we call Jeans Friday for our office associates. If you pay $1 per week, you are allowed to wear blue jeans on Fridays.
All of that money, along with money from several other fundraisers throughout the year, is then donated to Caring and Sharing.
What we do with the money then is we have a small account, and it's open for associates that maybe had a little hard luck and got behind on a bill or two, and they'll come to us and say, "Can you help us out?"
Bob says the biggest fulfillment he gets is being able to create jobs for people and see employees progress from position to position and continue to move forward.
As the CEO of the company, I can walk away and feel good about the fact that we have helped so many people and will continue to help so many people with the growth of the company.
It doesn't look like a whole lot right now, but this is actually phase two for this facility. And starting in April, it's where Shears is going to produce potato chips. In Massillon, I'm Jennifer Boris for Western Reserve PBS.
Are you not doing business as usual? Then email us at neotropolis.org. Tell us how you're changing your business, organization, or government agency to compete in the new economy. And who knows, you could be starring on NEOtropolis, Not Business as Usual. So we took a look at snack food manufacturing from a microeconomic point of view. Now we talk with experts in the field for a macroeconomic perspective, or what we like to call fly-eye economics.
With over 4,000 lenses, the eyes of a common housefly are among the most complex in the insect world.
With us tonight are panelists Ani Abi, Community Development Director for the City of Massillon, and Stephanie Smith, Green Building Consultant and Sustainability Coordinator at Stark State College of Technology. Folks, thanks so much for being with us this evening.
Thank you very much.
Leadership in energy and environmental design. And a lot of people watching still thinking, what is this LEED certification all about? If you would get in depth on that for us,
sure. Stephanie. Absolutely. We're using it at Stark State College for all of our new construction buildings right now. And it really looks, it's a third-party verification system. It's an internationally known green rating system for buildings. And it focuses on buildings that minimize their impact on land, water, and air, while also conserving energy and promoting healthy interior environments.
How much of a challenge is it to achieve this certification, especially the platinum designation?
Well, for this project, the in the city of Massillon, the L in LEAD stands for leadership. And it was Bob Shearer's vision when he was going to do a plant expansion to do it to a LEED standard. He was initially thinking that it would be a gold standard. But as they got into it, they found that there has never been a LEED certified food manufacturing facility in the United States. So they had to work with their engineering team to come up with specifications and work through the process of everything that had to be done to make that building LEED certified. And when they got to the end point and were going through the final certification process with the LEED Council, they found if they just did a little bit more, they could achieve a platinum designation, which is the highest that you can get. And they decided to see if they could go for it, and they made it. And they're the only, I think, LEED gold or platinum LEED certified facility like this in the United States. They've really set a new standard for a modern manufacturing facility, and it's the first one in the country, and it's located here in Northeast Ohio, in Massillon. We're very excited that it came here.
Have it, sure, yeah. Absolutely. Do you feel they might serve and set the lead for other businesses to follow suit?
I think so. Platinum is really a high standard. You see a lot more buildings, or many more buildings, actually striving for the silver and gold standards. And those can truly be achieved with a minimal cost increase. The key to achieving those is really involving the idea of green and high-performance building at the onset of your project. Even starting from site selection throughout the design process, the construction process, and even when the occupants actually use the building. They need to understand how to use that building. And then you need to go back and check and make sure that all of the systems are operating to their optimal modes. So that's all part of what LEED's looking at. It's not only about new construction, but it's also about existing construction. So it's absolutely worth it, and this is a great example.
I know when they achieved this for this new plan in Massillon, that Bob Shearer thought he would now try to retrofit his other facilities that he has to try to get them also certified under a LEED standard. And I
think that achievable.
I think they think that it is. This wasn't an easy process to go through. Bob Shearer started his planning for his expansion back in 2007. So it's something that took a while to get through all the design criteria. They knew that it would be a little bit more expensive to build the facility this way, but they're thinking that they're going to save 30% in their operating costs. Wow. With the energy efficiencies that they're able to achieve with the windows and the skylights that they have, the rainwater capture system, the way that they're recapturing heat from their equipment processes and using that to heat water in the building and to heat the building itself, and all those things will help to lower their cost of operations, which for a business, that's a good investment if you can do that.
Talk about the importance of what they've done here for Northeast Ohio, and certainly for the Massillon area.
Well, for Massillon, what this plan is doing, this is an expansion. This is not a relocation. Yeah. They're establishing new manufacturing lines for tortilla chips in the first phase and for kettle-cooked potato chips in the second phase. They're going to have a 150,000 square foot new facility with new jobs of between 150 to 170 new jobs. Shears is taking applications right now using our rec center as their base, and so this is new employment opportunities for Stark County, sure, Northeast Ohio residents.
I think in terms of green buildings, this is one of 40 buildings within the Akron-Canton area that's registered for LEED, and one of 400 in Northeast Ohio. So it's not just a trend. This is a movement that's here to stay. As we look to both coasts, we can see that these new green building standards are actually part of the building code, and eventually that will come to our area. So these are policies and procedures and methods that we do need to start adapting and getting used to. And I think it's great that it's in our backyard.
This is all part of, I think, some of Shearer's corporate philosophy.
Okay.
They call their employees aren't their workers, they're their associates. So they're also involved, you know, they're more involved, invested in the company itself. And I think this type of plant will be a more comfortable environment for people to work in, and I think it'll just be, you know, a win-win all the way around.
Well, Shears makes great Ripple potato chips. So could this possibly have an even more of a ripple effect throughout the state and perhaps beyond?
Sure. Yeah. Any time that you have a new green building facility come up to online, it's setting the standard. And certainly if you say, okay, a fruit production plant can do it, right, why can't this building do it? Habitat for Humanity is building lead in Canton. They have it's a LEED Gold and NAHB Gold building. If Habitat can build an affordable house with volunteer labor, why aren't we all doing it? So it's really raising expectations, and I think as a community we see that, and we will expect more from our builders and our developers.
How about in neighborhood development? Do you foresee this becoming more of a trend as well?
Well, some of the programs that the city operates for housing activities, just like Stephanie had mentioned, with the Habitat has built homes in Massillon using those same environmentally conscious materials. And we've had new housing developers who have tried to go through and learn more about green building techniques. And we've gotten grants from the federal and state government to build homes like this where they know that the occupants of those homes are going to be saving money on their utility bills, just the way that these things are constructed. And it'll be safer to live in with, you know, lower VOC paints and carpeting and better insulation, and just the way that the house itself is sealed, that it's just going to be a healthier environment to live in homes like that.
I like just to tag on another really important part of the LEED system is called sustainable sites. And when you talk about neighborhoods, it's really about bringing all of your different community resources together and creating a higher density. You know, so you start talking about walkable districts, you know, so you can you live, you work,
great point,
you send your kids to school, daycare, they're all within a short distance, which reduces our reliance on our single-use vehicles, on our cars, and then increasing mass transit and things like that. That's a really important aspect of it.
We have less than a minute left here, but how do we get the message out to have more businesses get in this line of thinking and what Shears and obviously other businesses can do with this?
I think as Shears was building this plant, it generated a lot of publicity.
Yeah.
And when they had their groundbreaking, they had representatives from the federal government, the governor was there, the Secretary of Transportation from the federal government was there, and it generated a lot of favorable publicity. And I think when businesses can see the bottom line, that this type of sustainability will be good for their operations, that I think even though it might cost a little more upfront to do these things,
sure,
that it will be, you know, successful for them in the long term.
Absolutely, great point. Well, unfortunately, we're out of time, but thanks so much for being with us this evening. Great input, and appreciate you being here.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, folks. Well, we plan and plan for the future, right? But sometimes you just have to let the chips fall where they may. And with that, it's time now for Into the Future, tonight with United Polymer Technologies.
Into the future.
I am Sebastian Kanakanaj, Professor Emeritus of the University of Akron. I am chairman and CEO of United Polymer Technology, located in Akron Global Business Accelerator. We specialize in color change technology, color change polymers, color change inks, laser inks, paper, and fabrics. Among the consumer items are color change candles, color change toys, color change t-shirts, and flameless clear gel candles. Color change is affected by stimuli such as heat, light, water, moisture, electricity, pressure, or combination of these. Coloration as well as erasure by light, heat, water, and electricity is also our unique technology. Controlled and timed release and timed coloration, piezoluminescence, or spark in the dark are within our technology. In the biomedical area, we have developed artificial spine disc stent balloon, patented cancer prophylactic, waiting for funds for FDA application. We custom develop products such as heat stable photochromic lenses, reusable paper, color changing toothbrush, and color changing hand wash soap. Our latest invention is the low cost electrochromic smart window to reduce the cost of energy of heating houses and buildings. 330-714-6059, www.crystalglow.net. Thank you.
You know, we also like to scan the financial landscape, and the expert to help us do that now is Elizabeth Verner, now with the Stock Wrap.
This week's local company stock spotlight is Invacare. Invacare is a global leader in the home and long-term care industries, manufacturing a range of products from patient beds, mobility devices, and everyday in-home personal care products. Invacare strives to push the evolution of in-home care to further the abilities and lives of their clients. Today, with the world's broadest product offerings, Invacare serves more than 25,000 independent home medical equipment and long-term care providers. Invacare began in the late 1970s. At that time, Technicare, a Cleveland-based medical device manufacturer, was purchased by Johnson & Johnson. Johnson & Johnson decided to sell the wheelchair division, known as Invacare. Today, Invacare continues to stick to their roots and manufactures wheelchairs and other mobility devices in their diverse product line. Invacare's objective is to produce innovative home medical products that promote recovery and active lifestyles. The look and use in Invacare wheelchairs have come a long way during the last 30-plus years. In 2008, at the Paralympic Games in Beijing, China, Invacare helped competitors bring home more than 120 medals with their top-end sports wheelchairs and hand cycles. Invacare is headquartered in Elyria, Ohio, and trades under the symbol IVC. The midweek close was $29.56. Year-to-date, the stock is negative 1.99%, and over the last 5 years, the stock is down 9.74%. Back to you, Jim.
Culture and entertainment in Northeast Ohio. It may qualify for platinum status. We think so. And our leader in energy on that, of course, is Cool Cleveland's Thomas Mulready. He joins us now to tell you about some other events that are going on in NEOtropolis this weekend. What we're talking about is the business of fun.
Hey, it's Thomas Mulready from CoolCleveland.com, and we're here today at the Akron-Canton Airport. It's actually right on the border of Akron and Canton, and we're talking this week about traveling to all corners of the region for cool stuff to do. Leave your home, and you don't necessarily need to get on a plane, but travel around the region. For example, in Canton, at the Canton Museum of Art, Saturday the 22nd, they're doing a program called Art Splash. The Canton Ballet, Players Guild, they're doing a little Canton Idol. That should be a fun event. And then in Lorain, they got a cool event called Inverse Lorain. This is on Saturday the 28th. It's a poetry and performing arts extravaganza. They've got a Nepali poet, Yuyusutu Sharma. They've got music by one of my favorite bands, Trenchcoat Manifesto, their cool local band, Rafael Rivera. And also in Lake County, all the way at the other end of the region, they've got the Lake County Chili Open on Saturday the 22nd. Get this, it's at the Blackbrook Golf Course. 9 holes, that's right, no matter what the weather. They're going to scrape the snow off the course. And they shortened it a little. It's to 65 to 100 yards. And then at the end of it, you get a big bowl of chili. So great stuff to do all throughout the region. Check it out. This is Thomas Mulready from CoolCleveland.com. Have a great week in NEOtropolis.
You're thinking, what else can I do to help the Northeast Ohio economy? It's pretty easy. All you have to do is get out to any of the events Thomas told us about and make your investment in fun. You can also position yourself out there and make some brilliant comments about the Northeast Ohio economy to the people in the snack aisle and tell them to spread the word. In the meantime, log on to our website, neotropolis.org, and tell us what you think. I'm Jim Evans. We'll see you next week on NEOtropolis, not business as usual.
Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by The Burton D. Morgan Foundation, committed to the free enterprise system. The Dominion Foundation. JumpStart, working with entrepreneurs to accelerate the growth of their high-potential businesses to create a more prosperous economic future for Northeast Ohio. The Raymond John Wien Foundation. Youngstown Business Incubator.
Next week on NEOtropolis, more buzz, stock wrap, and into the future. Find out who is not doing business as usual. Now stay tuned for Newsnight.